Study today will be verses 21 through 43. Mark's Gospel, the fifth chapter, verses 21 through 43. While you are finding your way there, let me introduce the text by asking a few questions and making a few statements. Mark's Gospel, the fifth chapter, you find the power of Jesus in the vivification of his casting out the demons, the power of Jesus over demons. And then you see in the balance of the chapter the power of Jesus over disease and even over death. In the 21st through the 43rd verse, very unique unit of thought where we see a miracle within a miracle. But the key element of what we find in the text is what I simply like to call in the waiting room, especially in God's waiting room. So the question is, how many of us have spent some time, you need not say amen or oh me or identify, but how many of us at given times down through the years have spent many hours in waiting rooms? I just a few days ago went over to one of the tire places that they had, 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, they had serviced the car, and I went back in for them to top the fluids off and to check it out. And I walked in, and a stream of people coming in, all the bays just about filled. And I walked in, and it was about 100 degrees outside, and I walked in the waiting room, and it was warmer inside than outside. It was difficult in the waiting room. The air conditioning was out, and the manager, Terry, apologized for it. And I said, well, that's all right. I said, I'll just prop the door open for you if you'd like me to and keep it cooler inside. But a waiting room. Some of us have spent considerable time in waiting rooms, waiting in a waiting room to see somebody for a job interview. A dental waiting room. That's not pleasant. Dental waiting room. Waiting for an attorney. Or waiting in a waiting room for an accountant, auto repairs. Waiting in a doctor's waiting room is probably the top of the list that brings up. Have you ever been in a doctor's waiting room and it seems they call everybody else before you? And time you walk back, the first thing the nurse wants to do is take your blood pressure. And the blood pressure is already sky high because if you're trying to find a place to park and then waiting. But doctor's waiting rooms are perhaps some of the most difficult areas because we're waiting. And generally in a doctor's waiting room, we're prone to be a little impatient. Some of us will confess to that. Simply because you're not feeling well. We're not feeling well. We're ill. We're sick. We want to see the doctor. One of the worst places, if you're not sick, to sit in is a doctor's waiting room, because whatever is there, you're going to take back with you sitting in the doctor's waiting room. How about a hospital emergency room where you are in the emergency room, you're waiting, perhaps a loved one, friend, relative, neighbor is in the emergency room, and you're there waiting, waiting for the medical team to come out and let you know the condition of the husband or the wife or the child. It's difficult in waiting in a waiting room. It's the unknown. Yet may I suggest that the most difficult waiting room that we'll ever wait in is God's waiting room. You say, well, I don't fully fathom that. What are you talking about, God's waiting room? At one time or another, everyone on the side of my voice, including this preacher, we will be in God's waiting room, or we have been in God's waiting room, or we're presently in God's waiting room, where we have sought God. We have come before God in our prayers and our pleading with God to answer and to give relief of the pain and the problem, the plight and the difficulties that face us, and yet it seems that God is silent. No answer. No response. Sometimes we're prone to ask the question, what is God doing? Doesn't he care? Is he asleep? Is he on vacation? Is there some reason that God is not answering my prayer? The answer to that is he's not asleep, he's not on vacation, and it's not asking the question, doesn't he really care? Yes, he cares for each and every one of us. Why doesn't he respond? Why doesn't he answer? Why doesn't he give us a response and just answer the and resolve the question, the problem that's on our hearts and that we're dealing with in our lives? God wants to teach us more often than not, he is has us in his waiting room to teach us to how to completely, totally depend upon him. In more cases than we would ever dream, God is planning and preparing our hearts for his supernatural intervention with what he would have for us, some answer that he wants to give us that he must prepare us for first. May I ask us to think for a moment on the subject in God's waiting room. And out of honor and respect for the reading of the word, I invite us to stand. As we stand together and as I read audibly, follow with me in your scripture silently. Mark's Gospel, the 5th chapter, verse 21 and following. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet, and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come, and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus, very important verse, the 24th verse, and Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman with an issue of blood, 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind, and touched his garment. For she said, If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing of himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, Who touched my clothes? And his disciples said unto him, Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing that what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. When he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? And as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, Be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, save or except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, Why makest ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were with him, and entered in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand, and said unto her, Talakuma, which is being interpreted, Damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given her to eat. Thank you, and we may be seated. There are four things that I want us to notice as we think on the subject in God's waiting room. So we have the picture before we go into the text. Jairus comes to Jesus. His daughter, according to the 42nd verse, is 12 years old and she's dying. And as Jesus turns to go with him, another emergency is revealed. This woman that had had an hemorrhage for 12 years. By the way, it's fascinating. The daughter's 12 years old. The woman's been suffering for 12 years. Now, some numerologists might make something out of that I don't believe is in the scripture, but it's fascinating to find that in the text. But in the midst of Jesus about to go with the ruler of the synagogue to go back and heal his daughter, he stands and watches as Jesus digresses from his journey to help him and helps another. And while doing that, his daughter dies. That's a tough job, waiting in God's waiting room. But I want us to notice four things as we think on the subject in God's waiting room. Notice, first of all, the desperate condition recorded in verses 21 through 24, and then the delay carefully revealed in verses 25 through 34, and then the devastating communication received in verse 35 and 36, and the fourth thing that we will see, the dead child raised, verse 37 through 43. Notice, first of all, what I call the desperate condition recorded. Notice in that 21st verse, the circumstances detailed are determined. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. Perhaps you've noticed in the shuttling for Jesus, here he is, goes from the eastern shore to the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. And he keeps that shuttling, and he ministers on each shore as he's there. But keep in mind, this has happened now a couple of times during the fifth chapter of the Gospel according to Mark. But keep in mind, he has left the previous shore because the people in the community and all the roundabout cities had gotten bent out of shape, if I can use that term. They'd gotten bent out of shape with him because he had cast the demons, 6,000 of them, out of a man. He had cast them into the swine that the demons had requested. He cast them into the swine, and 2,000 swine, hogs, pigs, I'm from the country, 2,000 pigs wound up being demon-possessed and ran violently, the scripture says, over the embankment, and they were drowned. As a result of that, the pig owners and the pig keepers and all of the citizens, because it was taken away as they looked at it, their bread and butter, because these were Jewish people bootlegging pork, if you will. And as a result of what they were doing, the pigs are dead. And as a result of that, they want Jesus to leave their city. They want Jesus to exit quickly and no longer remain there. And one of the problems that you find in society today generally is that society is more interested in making money and having position and power and prestige than the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. They'd ask him to leave. And as one writer commented, and I was fascinated by this, said one crowd sighed with relief as they saw Jesus leave, but the other crowd was waiting to welcome him. Very interesting. In God's waiting room, there are two people in the text, Jairus, and he's waiting for Jesus to heal his daughter. And then the unnamed woman, I find it fascinating that the woman is not named. The unnamed woman that's suffering with an incurable disease. That's those are the circumstances that's determined, that causes and is the outfall of the balance of the text and what we'll see in this story that is before us today. This biblical truth that ought to grasp our hearts and the realization and the recognition that we can pray and plead and seek God and ask for relief and ask for direction and ask for wisdom and strength and encouragement and comfort and hope. And sometimes it seems as though that just simply does not happen, does not occur. But God is not asleep. He's not dead. He's not on some far journey. God is still on his throne, still watching over and meeting our need. I want us to notice, secondly, in verse 22 through 24, the confidence displayed. I want you to notice the confidence. The scripture says, "And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him," that's Jesus, "he fell at his feet." I want us to notice three or four things about this man. It's fascinating because unless we understand the custom and the culture and the setting in relationship to the rulers of the synagogue, we'll not fully see the impact of this man coming before the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice, first of all, his daring. His daring. He is a religious leader in the synagogue. The religious leaders in the synagogue of that era, of that day, hated the Lord Jesus Christ. They felt that they were more religious. They felt that they were more prestigious. They felt that they were more powerful. They had a little more piety than the Lord Jesus Christ. After all, he is a lowly carpenter's son. After all, he is simply one that does not have the letters. He's not gone to the Ivy League schools. He does not have the lettered jacket. He's not one that's recognized with the degrees after his name. He is just simply a lowly rabbi. But here is this synagogue leader. He is daring because He's not afraid of the other synagogue leaders to see him. He's not ashamed to be seen with the Lord Jesus Christ. Why is that so? Because of his absolute desperation. He fell at his feet. He felt more spiritual. These synagogue leaders felt more spiritual and more religious. But when it came down to his daughter is dying, he determined, I don't care who sees me. I don't care what they say. I don't care if I get kicked out of the synagogue. It doesn't make any difference. I want my daughter to be healed and her to be well. He comes to the point of desperation. He publicly falls before the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no shame, no fear of what other synagogue leaders might say about him or do to him. Notice not only his daring and his desperation, but notice his desire in 23 and 24. And besought, that's to beg, to plead him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, go and lay thy hands on her that she may be healed and she shall live. Somewhere, somehow, he knew what Jesus could do. He somehow, some way, knew without any equivocation that if Jesus Christ would simply go in and lay hands on his daughter, that she would be healed and made well. He had a deep, deep desire that his child be healed. Here's a man with a desperate need. He is hopeless. He is helpless before the Lord Jesus Christ. He voices his deepest desire to see his little girl live and to be healed. He has faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that he can do the healing. And he comes to Jesus, listen carefully. He comes to him not in piety, not in prestige, not out of position, but in absolute humility before the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. May I suggest that more often than not, in 21st century Christendom, that we have that starched attitude that we do not need to come and cast aside our pride and our position and piety and peel it all off and just in humility before the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ plead with him that our need be met and that he answer our prayer. There's a mindset somehow that we ought never to weep, we ought never to cry, we never should fall on our knees. There should never be a time that we show sheer desperation before God. That's the mindset so often today. He comes with a humble spirit. He comes with a surrendered will and a surrendered heart before the Lord Jesus. There's no pretense in his life. There's no more show of piety and prestige and position as a religious leader of his day. Verse 24 says, in Jesus, pivotal verse, and Jesus went with him. He didn't say, son, let me speak it and it'll take place. He didn't say, let's call out TBN and let's get the cameras and let's have a healing service. He didn't say, let's get the big crowd for them to see what I'm doing that they can write back and tell everybody what I've done as the great healer. He didn't say that. He just simply turned and went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. Literally, they pushed and crowded and shoved against him. Perhaps we've become too modern today. Perhaps we've become too sophisticated today. Perhaps we've become too starched today in our approach to the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe God wants us to come before him in our brokenness, in our humanness, in the humanity of our heart, and the realization that we can't, but God can, and come and pour our hearts out before God if we want God to deliver us and answer us and give us the healing and the health and the strength and the wisdom that he would have us to be his servants, surrendered to be salt and light in the society in which we live today. No pretense in this man as he comes before the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice not only the desperate condition recorded, but notice the delay carefully revealed in verses 25 through 34. This is the hinge that the door swings on. Here's a man that has a daughter that's dying. Here is the healing of that daughter. But the hinge in the center is this dear woman that comes to the Lord Jesus Christ also out of desperation and pleading with the Lord Jesus Christ in her heart with the faith that he can heal, and she just simply wants to touch the hem of his garment. Get the picture here. Jairus pleads and prays for Jesus that he'll go with him to his house, and he hears him and he follows him. And for verse 42, as I reminded us by way of introduction, the little girl is 12 years old. 12 years old. The crowd is large. The crowd is thronging. The crowd is pushing. The crowd is on every hand. But notice the condition that's described in verse 25 and through 27. Notice the scripture says, and a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. Listen to what's taking place. These verses tell us something here that took place as Jesus turns. Jesus turns. Here's Jairus that is talking with him. And as he talks with him, he tells him what's happening and what he wants. And Jesus, in essence, says, okay, let's go. And he turns to walk. And immediately then, he senses that something has taken place. Because in that throng of people, in that crowd of people, in that whole push of people, there's some things that's taking place that's not seen on the surface, because the heart is seen by Holy God. Listen. Here is the scenario. Here's the situation. A woman which has an incurable disease is in the crowd. She's pushing and she's pushing and she's pushing to get to Jesus. She too is pushing out of desperation. Notice the problem in verse 25. This dear woman has an incurable disease, hemorrhaging, that is slowly destroying her life. She suffered for 12 long years. There's a sense of hopelessness and helplessness, but in her mind's eye, in her heart, she's heard about Jesus. She knows that he's in the crowd, and she says, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. That's faith in the heart of this dear woman. Notice not only do we see her problem, but notice her pain. The scripture says, and she had suffered many things of many physicians. I made a little margin note. Sounds almost like Obamacare, doesn't it? She went to the doctor, and she went from one doctor to the other. Have you ever been to a doctor? And you heard the story about the dear lady went to the doctor. The doctor said, well, where do you hurt? And she said, all over. And he says, that ever happened before? And she said, yeah. And he said, well, it's happening again. I've discovered that when you go to a physician, if you're not already searched up and researched up and know about what's happening in your body, you may as well hang it up if you think the doctor's going to sit there and tell you. That's the reason they're called practicing physicians. We're the guinea pig. They're practicing on us. Now listen, I'm very thankful for physicians, but they're practicing. Many have said doctors do not have to do anything. They bury their mistakes. And may I simply say that as sad as that sounds, that's probably real. But this dear lady was in deep, deep pain. She had been to doctor after doctor after doctor, and I believe that most of us can identify with her. Constant agony and constant pain and constantly hoping that maybe this next doctor, this next exam, this next MRI, this next physician will be able to find my problem and cure the disease or whatever it is, the malady that ails me. But not only do we see her problem and her pain, but notice her poverty in verse 26. And had spent all that she had. Listen, she is in constant pain. She is in constant agony, but she has become poverty-stricken as a result of the medical bills. There are multitudes in America today that wind up having to file financial bankruptcy as a result of hundreds of thousands of dollars in medical bills. You ever read your insurance report when you get it back, tell you how much they spent on your medication, et cetera, et cetera? A pill that should be 50 cents at the most, they bill it out at $50, $100, or $300, and then tell you how much they paid on it, how much you're supposed to pay for the balance of it. I found in doing research down through the years that we do the pharmaceutical research in America. We develop the genius of the medication, and then it's manufactured in other parts of the world, and other parts of the world pay pennies on the dollar compared to what we pay for it. This dear lady is absolutely poverty-stricken. In fact, and you studied the text, and she had spent all, literally in the Greek text, it indicates that she is bankrupt as a result of the medical bills that she has suffered. She cannot pay the medical bills. Thousands of dollars if you put it in the 21st century vernacular. Not only do we see her problem, her pain, and her poverty, but notice her perplexity. And was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. Every doctor you go to, you get a little worse. Every doctor you go, you ever try to read a medical doctor's prescription? You try to read it and you can't, you know what it says? I've got my $10, you get yours. That's a shorthand for what it says on that prescription. But she had spent all, and in that spending all, she's perplexed. She got no better. She got worse. The physicians could not find her cure. She grew worse and worse, also due to her condition, according to what is not mentioned here, but according to the Levitical ceremonial law. As a result of her condition, she was considered ceremonially unclean. That means that she could not go to and fro as the normal person. She could not even go into the temple for worship because of her condition being called ceremonially as being unclean. So religiously and societally, she was considered unclean. I made a little marginal note. Wow, what a burden this dear woman for 12 years had suffered under and had carried, and she was getting worse and worse and worse. But notice in that 27th verse what I call her push. When she had heard of Jesus, we do not know how she heard about it. Maybe it was in the local gazette. Maybe it was by telephone, telegraph, telewoman, as they say. Maybe somehow she got the news that Jesus was in the crowd. It didn't make any difference how she got the news. She knew that Jesus was there. She knew that if she could just get to Jesus, all of her problems would be resolved. She knew that if she could just touch the garment, that she would be made whole. Her push. She did not allow anything or anybody to keep her from the Lord Jesus Christ. Her family, her friends could not stop her. Not as so often today, people say, well, my job wouldn't let me go to church. My job wouldn't let me worship. Because of my job, I couldn't study the scripture. Because of my, it didn't make any difference. And may I suggest, when we have a sense of desperation, when we get to the point and position in our lives that we know that our only hope, our only help is the Lordship of Jesus Christ, it will no longer make any difference what someone thinks or says or what they do or what they may say about us. It will not make any difference about a job or what time we get up or what time we go to bed or the appointment that we keep. It totally revolutionizes our thought and our attitude about time and importance and priorities in our lives. And this dear lady's priorities had been totally changed. This dear lady's priority was saying to her in her heart, if I can just get to Jesus. And by the way, when we talk about faith, she might have looked on the surface that she had a little faith, but that was great faith. She wanted to get to the Lord Jesus Christ. She knew that that would revolutionize her life. She could have used any number of excuses to convince her to stay away, not try to push to Jesus. Perhaps she thought, I'm not important. Picture now, this is a dear woman, unnamed. This is one that, if you'd put it in the vernacular, simply was part of the crowd, part of the throngs of people. No emphasis on who she is. But here's the man that Jesus is standing with. Here's the man that Jesus is about to walk away with. And I'm sure that everyone in the crowd recognized this man as being one of the religious leaders from down at the synagogue. I'm sure that she recognized that, and perhaps she thought in her heart, perhaps she could have said, this man is more important than me. This man has priority and prestige and position. I'm a nobody. I'm a nada. I'm a nothing. Why should Jesus bother with me? Why should he be concerned about me? And there are multitudes today that have that philosophy, that Jesus does not care. He is not concerned because I'm simply a nobody. He is not concerned because I'm not in the priority structure of life. But Jesus Christ cares for you. And the scripture tells us to cast your cares upon him, for that he cares for you. It doesn't make any difference who we are. Unnamed, unknown, no prestige, no position. Jesus Christ cares. And this dear lady wanted to get to Jesus Christ for her healing and for her health and for her deliverance. What's our excuse today? She didn't try to use an excuse. She could have said, well, the crowd's too big. And after all, I don't like crowds. The crowd is too pushy. And after all, I don't want to get pushed around. I might get trouble. She could have said, well, this man's more important and I'm a nobody. Why should I try? He's already headed down the street with this man that's one of the religious leaders. The condition described, but notice in verse 28 through 32, the cure directed. Verse 28, for, the little Greek word there is gar. I like the other understanding of the word cause or because. If you're from the north, it's because. If you're from the south, it's just cause. Verse 28, because, for she said, if I may touch but his clothes. She didn't say that one time. In the Greek text, it's in the continuing voice. She kept muttering to herself, under her breath, perhaps with the mumbling of her lips, if I can just touch him, if I can just get to his garment, if I can just touch his clothes, if I can just get close to him, if I can just reach out and touch the hem of his garment. Notice, and straightway, that means immediately. By the way, the Gospel of Mark, that word straightway is used more than any other of the synoptic Gospels. Gospel of Mark is a gospel of immediacy. And straightway, meaning immediately, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus immediately, knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, "Who touched me? Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said unto him, "Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest, Who touched me?" And he looked round about to see, her that had done this thing. Listen very carefully. We see here the real, active, passionate faith. For she said, "If I can just touch his clothes, if I can just touch his garments, I shall be whole." Verse 29 says, immediately, when she reached out by faith and touched Jesus' garments, the scripture says immediately she's healed. Just by touching his garments, she pushes through, she gets through the crowd. She doesn't care about the press. And by the way, it's not ABC, NBC, or CBS press. It's talking about the throngs of people, the crowd that is there. It's not talking about that in any other sense other than that which oftentimes keeps us from Jesus, that which oftentimes prevents us from standing up and letting our faith be real, from allowing the power of the Holy Spirit of God to work in and through us for us to be what the Lord Jesus Christ wants us to be. The scripture says then in the 30th verse, Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned to him about to the press in the press and said, "Who touched me? Who touched my clothes?" Verse 31 is interesting because the disciples, in essence, if you put it in the young blood vernacular, they said, "Jesus, are you a fruitcake? Are you nutty? Are you crazy? Jesus, don't you understand that everybody here has touched you? Don't you realize that everybody here that's thronging you, that's pressing in somehow, some way, they've rubbed elbows with you, they've bumped shoulders with you, they've stepped on the hem of your garment, they've in somehow, some way, everybody in the crowd, Jesus, all of these people, somehow they've touched you." That's their thought. But you see, only one out of all the crowd, only one out of all the throng of people, only one out of all the press reached out with a touch of faith, reached out by faith to touch Jesus Christ. This dear woman that has suffered all of those years with all of the pain and perplexity and poverty and brokenness and the debilitating condition that she was in, she would journey through the crowd and push here and push there. And all the time she's doing it, she's saying in her heart, she's saying through her lips, she is repeating in her mind, "If I can just get to Jesus, if I can just get to Jesus." And may I simply say to all of us listening today, that ought to be the mantra of our heart, that if we can just get to Jesus, the idea is that only Jesus Christ can heal, only Jesus Christ can save, only Jesus Christ can perform that miracle in your life and in my life. And this dear woman is seeking to reach out and touch. It's that real faith. All the others touched Jesus and no miracles took place. Nobody was cured but one, and that one was because she reached out in faith. Verse 32, Jesus stopped. He stopped. And he said that he looked around to the woman that had touched him. We see the omniscience of Jesus Christ. We see the fact that Jesus Christ knows it all. There's nothing hidden. There's nothing secret. There's not a secret thought in your mind, in your heart, in our lives that Jesus Christ is not aware of. He is omnipotent. He is omnipresent. He is omniscient. He knows and sees our hearts. Listen to the fascinating thought of this text. The moving and pushing, and perhaps synagogue ruler is there to his side as they're going to his house. And all of a sudden, God come in the flesh. All of a sudden, Jesus Christ, Savior, Master, and Lord. All of a sudden, Jesus senses that someone has reached out and touched him in faith. And he turns, and he didn't have to say, "Who touched me?" in that he didn't know, as the loose likes lost liberal theologians will tell us. That's not the idea. He asked the question publicly because he wanted the woman to publicly confess that she's the one that reached out by faith in touching the Lord Jesus Christ. He wanted her to admit, he wanted her to testify to the fact that she had reached out by faith touching the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus wants to be more than just our healer. He wants to have a relationship with you and me. He wants to have a relationship and a friendship relationship with us. Jesus wants her to publicly acknowledge him as Savior and as Lord. May I simply say, there are many folks today that have the philosophy, I'll just be a silent, secret disciple of Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus, if he saved us, wants us to acknowledge it publicly. He wants us to be willing to stand and say, I identify with Jesus Christ. I'm saved, 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 blood bought, Bible saved, born again, without fear, without any intimidation. I'm on the side of Jesus Christ. And may I suggest that that's what's needed in America today more than anything else in this world. It's for Christians to take a stand with a backbone and a spine and say, I'm saved, and I'm not intimidated by the moral, ethical declension that's taking place and all of those that are purveyors of all of that garbage that's destroying our society today. This dear lady is confronted with Jesus calling on her to testify of her faith in him. Calling on her to be a public, verbal, visible witness. Jesus wants us to acknowledge him before others. We see the condition described and the cure directed. But notice the confession declared in verse 33 and 34. Please realize, recognize this woman had faith. It was weak faith. It was timid faith. But it was also strong faith. She kept on saying to herself, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. Now she's been made whole. Now she's healed. And Jesus wants her to publicly confess him as master. Notice verse 33. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. It's kind of a little point of interest to me where the scripture says she told him all the truth. Did she think she could do less? Is it possible that somehow we see mirrored here what we so often think is that we can give a partial truth, a half truth, or a shadow of the truth to the Lord, and somehow, some way, we can bluff him into believing that that's really the facts when he knows our hearts? He knew our heart and your life. He knew everything about her, but he wanted her to witness for him. He wanted her to publicly say, Jesus Christ, you're a master, Lord, Savior, you've delivered me. The scripture says she fell down in humility and worshiped the Lord Jesus Christ and confessed all that she had suffered and now is made whole and healed. She told him everything. He already knew. May I suggest, and if I'd put it in the young blood vernacular, she said, Jesus, let me tell you about my past 12 years. Let me tell you about all of the torment that I've gone through. Let me tell you about all of the devastation. Let me tell you all of the calamity. Let me tell you all that I've spent. Let me tell you the doctor's names and addresses and who they are so that no one else go to see them. Do you ever do that? Don't ever see that doctor. He's not good for you. She told him everything that had taken place. And she also told him, I'm whole. I've been healed. I know it in my body. I feel it in my body. I've been made well. Verse 34, and he, that is Jesus, said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Now, the average reader can just read right over that. Thy faith hath made thee whole. He's not talking about just the physicality. He's not talking about just the physical malady. He's not talking about just the physical incurability. He is talking about body, spirit, emotionally and spiritually, and for the soul, body, soul, and spirit, healed and saved. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. You see, there are multitudes today that are seeking the health from Jesus, seeking wealth from Jesus. If you turn on the Heresy Broadcast Networks, that's all you see. Telling you how you can bribe God and get God to bless you somehow with dollars. Furthest thing from the biblical truth. The only ones that make money are the charlatans that are peddling the lie. And they're getting wealthy as a result of it. But here, I want us to understand. This dear lady realized and recognized that she had been made well. She's whole. And Jesus pronounces her healed, whole, body, soul, and spirit. She's saved as a result of her faith. And in that faith that saves, that faith also delivers her from that spiritual, physical malady also. 12 long years spent suffering in pain and agony and disappointment over and over again. But wait a moment. We rejoice in that, but wait a moment. Jairus is standing there. He's waiting. Listen, I think sometimes we miss the picture, and I like to picture a text when I'm studying it. He's walking with the ruler of the synagogue. That journey that he's about to go to heal the daughter that's at the point of death, that journey is stopped. It's interrupted for Jesus to be able to have that communication with the woman. Jairus is standing there. He's watching. Perhaps his heart's pounding, thinking, Lord, don't you know where I hurt? Don't you know the need? Don't you know the urgency of what's taking place? My daughter is dying. He didn't verbalize that, but he's standing there. He's witnessing, he's watching as Jesus Christ performs the miracle in the woman's life. Perhaps he's thinking, doesn't Jesus care? Doesn't he realize the urgency of the moment? You remember in verse 24 it said, and Jesus went with him. But the crowds and the woman had such a great need. And here's Jairus' daughter dying. The desperate condition recorded. The delay carefully revealed. Notice the devastating communication received. Verse 35 and 36. If you've ever been in God's waiting room, waiting for a doctor to come out after long surgery and give the news to the waiting family, waiting for the results of some serious medical test, waiting for a husband, wife, or child to say yes to Jesus, waiting for that errant one to come back home, waiting for a medical miracle in your life, waiting for that wandering child that said no all of his life to Jesus to come to his senses. Why are we to sit in God's waiting room? What's the motivation of God? What is he doing? May I just interject three or four little brief points that I believe theologically, biblically, and basically in the analysis of the total of the text, some of the things that God is doing in keeping us oftentimes in his waiting room. Number one is to secure our focus. To secure our focus. Looking completely to the Lord Jesus Christ. Not to the medical world, not to the psychics and psychologists and psychiatrists, but to Jesus and Jesus only, to secure our focus. And secondly, to settle our fears. Fear not, for I am with thee, Jesus tells us in his word. Thirdly, to strengthen our faith. Nothing, the Bible says, nothing is impossible with God. And the fourth possibility when we're in God's waiting room is to surrender our future. Just as the old song, take my life and let it be only always used for thee. Where we simply come to the point and place saying, God, whatever you say, I'll do. Wherever you send, I'll go. I surrender my future to you. 19 78 when the physician said that I was going blind. And I'd been shuttled all over the state of Georgia to ophthalmologist and then sent to the Center of Ophthalmology at the Miami Eye Institute. And the doctor there that did the examination writes the textbooks on ophthalmology. But before I flew to Miami, walked around in my front yard there in Georgia, beautiful azaleas blossoming. I don't think they'd ever been more colorful. Very simple prayer. I said, Lord, I'm willing to preach for you, continue to preach for you if it's totally blind. But I'd sure love to have my sight. Went through 2 days of excruciating, mind-boggling examinations. Dr. Gass, when he finished the examination, I sat by his desk. And he said, what seemed to be your problem? I said, Doc, I thought you'd be able to tell me. He said, as far as I can determine in my evaluation and examination, when you're 90 years old, you should be able to pick up the newspaper and read it as well as you do today. I see nothing wrong. Did God do that? Yes. Did he perform a miracle? Yes. May I simply say, I believe that it could have been totally, totally different had it been on the basis that I wanted my way. But I said, Lord, your way's all right with me. And may I suggest that many times I believe God keeps us in his waiting room until we make that determination. I'm willing to do what you want me to do. I'll be your mouthpiece. Wherever you send me, I'll go. I want you to notice this communication delivered in that 35th verse. The scripture says, while he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? Literally, he brought him the bad news of the bad news. He said, listen, don't continue to bother the master anymore. Leave Jesus alone. Your little girl that's been suffering, your little girl that was at the point of death, your little girl, your daughter is now dead. That's the kind of news that we all fear and we all dread and we do not want to hear. The report is so devastating, so numbing. All the waiting, all the praying, and all the hoping, and all the anticipation of his daughter's being able to be made whole, and now she's dead. There's something that's so final. There's something that's just so numbing that we just stand in shock when we hear those words. Can you imagine his feeling? He had stood by waiting and watching as Jesus healed the woman. He saw firsthand Jesus' power at work. He knew that Jesus could do the impossible while someone was still alive. But listen, here's the daughter that's dead, and the news says she's dead. It's hopeless. You're helpless. He can do nothing now. I can just imagine Jesus' thoughts. That I am the master over life and death. I can just imagine Jesus' thoughts. What about Lazarus? He'd been dead for 3 days. And he was already in the tomb. And they say, by now, Lord, he stinketh. And he stood outside that tomb. And it said, Lazarus, come forth. And the Bible says, Lazarus came walking out of the tomb. And this is that same Jesus. And now the word is that she's dead. It's hopeless. There's nothing that could be done. Have you ever stood hopelessly and helplessly in a situation like that? And you hear what the doctors say, and you hear what the antagonists say, and you hear what the detractors say, and they'll tell you you can't, it can't be done. This situation that you're in, this scenario that you're faced with, the problem that you're dealing with, it's hopeless, nothing can be done. But Jesus Christ is the master over those hopeless circumstances and situations. He's the master over them. In fact, Dr. Lehman Strauss, wrote a book many years ago. And on page 16 and 17 of his book, in fact, the title of his book, of which I use the title, not the text or the thought, the title of his book is In God's Waiting Room, Dr. Lehman Strauss. In chapter 2, the beginning of the chapter, he makes these statements. Title of that chapter is God is in Control. It was Wednesday, April the 14th, 1982. 18 days had passed since Elsie's stroke. The neurologist in charge requested that I meet with him. I waited expectantly in the corridors outside Elsie's room. When the doctor appeared, his remarks were brief and pointed. "We're making arrangements to move your wife to a rehabilitation center in San Diego." "What led to your decision?" I asked. He hesitated. I detected a bit of concern in his delayed reply. I was right. His words came slowly when he made this statement. "There's nothing more that we can do medically. For you see, Ms. Strauss is at the point that we can no longer help." He placed his hand on my shoulder and patted it gently. "I'm so sorry," he said, and he walked away. For a few seconds, I stood motionless, my mind almost blank. Then I walked slowly into the room, kissed Elsie, sat in the chair beside her. She spoke first. "What did the doctor tell you?" "He said that you would be transferred to a rehabilitation center in San Diego." And the text continues with how they dealt with that, simply trusting God and believing God, by faith, trusting her. That communication that says, nothing more we can do. Notice in that 36th verse, the consolation directed. Notice what the scripture says in verse 36, when Jesus says then, "As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, Be not afraid, only believe." Listen to what Jesus is saying to him. Listen how Jesus responds. He didn't debate the communication. He didn't say, "Listen, I don't believe what they're saying." He heard it. Evidently, they walked up, publicly made the statement, gave him the information, and said right there before Jesus, "Leave him alone, stop bothering him. There's nothing more that can be done. The daughter's dead." When Jesus heard the words, what did he say? Did he say, "Well, you know, there's no point in me going now"? And did he say, "Well, you know, maybe I can do something tomorrow. Listen, I'll be praying for you," or something? He didn't say any of that at all. What did the Lord Jesus Christ say? He didn't even discuss it. He simply said, "Stop, do not continue to be fearful, but continue, keep on believing, having absolute faith on a continual basis." Listen to what Jesus is saying. Regardless of the problem, regardless of the situation, regardless of the news, regardless of what the doctors may say, regardless of what the economists may say, listen, keep on believing. Keep on having faith in God. Believe that He is still on the throne and He is still able. Keep on believing. It's easy to have faith when everything's all right. It's easy to have faith when there are groceries on the shelf and gas in the tank and health and a job. It's easy to say, "I believe in God." Take all of that away. Where's the faith? Where do we stand in our belief system? There's an old song that says, "Have faith in God, have faith in God. He's on His throne. He watches o'er His own. Have faith in God." Another old song says, "Nothing is impossible with God. When you put your trust in God, nothing is impossible when you trust in His Word." Nothing is impossible. In fact, at your leisure, you study the text in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter and the 13th verse. It talks about the trials and the troubles and the difficulties, and no testing has taken us by surprise. God is not surprised with anything that will test us and that will tempt us, because with every test, He provides, the scripture says, a way of escape. Jairus could have thought, "Jesus doesn't really care about me. He's not interested in me." Perhaps we, all of us at some time or other, felt that way. After all, if, you've heard that word, if He really cared for me, if He really thought anything about me, if He really wanted to help me, if He really wanted to take care of me, He would have done something sooner and my daughter would not have died. Or my problems would have gone away. again in Lehman Strauss's book. He says this, God is the creator and controller of the universe and all that is in it, whether animated or inanimate. God is accountable only to himself. He reports to no one else. He is not required to have, he's not required at any time to give to any person any explanation for anything that he says or does. He is the superpower above all powers in every area of his creation. We do not expect to understand fully the purpose of the trials until the Lord calls us home to be with him. But we do know that he loves us too much to harm us and that he is far more concerned with our welfare than we are. Nothing in his universe happens by chance or by accident. For every effect there is a cause. God worketh all things after the counsel of his own will that we should be to the praise of his glory. May I remind us, he's still on the throne. Just as in the day this text was written, he's still on his throne, watching over us all. Jesus says, keep on believing. But I want us to notice finally, in verse 37 through 43, the apex of the text, the crescendo of it all, the glory hallelujah portion to rejoice over. The other's good. But I want you to notice, not only do we see the desperate condition recorded and the delay carefully revealed, the devastating communication received, but I want us to notice quickly, in closing, the dead child raised, verse 37 through 43. All of this time, he is in God's waiting room. All of this time. Notice verse 37, 38. And he suffered, that means to allow, he allowed no man to follow him, save or except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. Notice the commotion displayed. By the way, in that era, in that culture, in that day, when a person died, they would literally hire the wailers. A group would come in, and for a certain fee, would lament and wail. Now, we don't fathom that, because we don't do that in the culture that we're in. That was part of the cultural expression of loss. And that's what's taking place. And the scripture says that when Jesus arrived at the house, and by the way, he took three people with him, Peter, James, and John, he didn't play the Benny Hinn approach. He didn't call out the news media and say, bring the camera, boys. I want to get a good tape on this so I can promote it on television and show the thousands upon thousands upon thousands that's flocking after me. I want everybody to see how popular I am. Jesus didn't do that at all. Jesus took with him three men, Peter, James, and John. Listen to what's taking place here. He did not allow the gawking of the crowd to follow him. No cameras and no media. Just Jesus and the girl's daddy and Peter and James and John. He allowed no one to go into the house. Recall, by the way, some might wonder about it, Peter, James, and John. They witnessed Jesus in his transfiguration, Peter, James, and John. It was Peter, James, and John that was with Jesus when he went into the Garden of Gethsemane and prayed as it were, great drops of sweat, as it were, great drops of blood before his crucifixion, before his arrest and the six phony, fake, false trials and his ultimate crucifixion. It was Peter, James, and John that was there with him. It was Peter, James, and John that authenticated his resurrection. And here, Peter, James, and John is with him. And Jesus watches as this tumult, this weeping, wailing, mourning crowd for the lost takes place. The sense of hopelessness and helplessness, people in despair. Have you ever been there? Every one of us either have been there, or we're going to be there at some given time. A sense of despair, of hopelessness, helplessness, the sense of absolute loss and inability to have any control of the circumstances and the situation. And in that midst of despair, Jesus hadn't moved an inch. He's still there. He's closer than our next breath. Notice the confrontation depicted in verse 39 and 40. Notice the scripture says, and when he was come in, he saith unto them, why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother and the damsel and them that were with him, Peter, James, and John, and entered in where the damsel was lying. Listen of the confrontation. May I remind us, Jesus says, what is all this about? Put in the vernacular, what are you weeping for? What are you wailing for? Why are you guys here even? What are you doing here? What is this all about? You see, death for the believer is not the end. He says she's not dead, she's asleep. And death for the child of God is not death when we leave that casket in that ground on some lonely hillside in some funeral, some cemetery far away. When we leave, it's not goodbye, it's good night. See you in the morning for the child of God. One grand glorious day, there'll be a homecoming celebration that the world has never experienced or will never know. When up from the grave, He calls us unto Himself in what we call the rapture. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. The dead in Christ shall rise first, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Death is not the end for the child of God. He says, stop weeping and stop wailing. Stop the tumult and the commotion. She is not dead. She's alive. May I remind us, Jesus is announcing that He is in total control and total charge. Verse 40 says, and they laughed at Him. And they laughed Him to scorn. But when He put them all out, He taketh the father and the mother and the damsel and them that were with Him, Peter, that's Peter, James, and John, and entered into the damsel where she was. You see, the presence of the mourners in the house was proof. God gave us this text. Because the presence of mourners in the house is proof that she was, in fact, physically dead. From the physical standpoint, she was dead. And when Jesus said that she was not dead, the disbelief brought scorn and laughter. May I remind us, the unbelieving world scorns the Lord Jesus Christ and all that He says. Scorns the Christian. Right now, there's a greater wave of Christian slaughter and Christian denigration than in the history of our nation, not only in our nation, but around the globe. Churches are being burned, Christians slain for their belief. The city of Mosul in Iraq, they had until yesterday, I don't know what they've done, for the thousands upon thousands of Christians to either convert to Islam, be beheaded, or to remain and submit to Islam and pay taxes, or to flee the country. Christians. And that's not newsworthy with most of the drive-by media today. In America, Christians are being denigrated and laughed at. The Bible is not supposed to be in a classroom because, as one judge ruled, it could psychologically harm that child irreparably so. And so that fifth grade teacher was told, you cannot have that Bible even unopened on your desk. It must be in the desk drawer at all times. Our society laughs at any Christian. There he goes, goody-goody two-shoes. He thinks he's better than I am. Or as the Bill Maher character on television said, all Christians just want to put their finger in the eye of non-believers. Christians are denigrated and laughed at. And these laugh at Jesus in disbelief and mockery. Notice finally, the command that's declared in verse 41 through 43. And He took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talakumai, that is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway, immediately, the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of about 12 years, and they were astonished, amazed, with great astonishment. And He charged them straightly that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given to her to eat. Listen, Jesus didn't make a skeptical out of the miracle. He simply commands to her, stand up. He didn't have any mumbo jumbo and any seance or a lot of these things that are touted as being the religious way and the spiritual way to do things today. He just said to her, stand up. You see, Jesus Christ is God. He has power over life and death. Immediately the little girl stands and walks. And this brought amazement and astonishment. The corollary text in Luke 8:55 says, "And her spirit came again, and she arose straightway, and he commanded to give her meat or food." Listen carefully. The evidence of life is hunger. The evidence of life is hunger. You show me a person that is not hungry for the Word of God, not hungry to read the Word, hear the Word, and to be where the Word is being proclaimed. You show me that individual, and I'll show you an individual that's probably as lost as a green ball in high weeds. You ever been on a golf course? That's lost. You show me a person that's been saved. They want to study the Word, know the Word, hear the Word, integrate the Word of God in their lives. He says, "Stand up." She stood. He said to the folks in the house, "Get her something to eat. She's alive. Feed her. She's alive. Feed her with food to give strength for her body." 8:56 of Luke says, "And he charged them that they should tell no man what was done." Divine delays. Sitting in God's waiting room. When calamity comes, when pain and anguish is ours that's unspeakable, God says, "Keep on trusting. Keep on faithing. Keep on believing." There's an old song that says, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. Through it all, I've learned to trust in God. If I never had a problem, I'd never know that he could solve them. And then an old, old song, a portion of it says, "He careth for you. He careth for you. Through sunshine and shadow, he careth for you." Perhaps today, you're seated in God's waiting room. Perhaps today, you're waiting and searching in agony. You know what Jesus says? Keep on faithing. Keep on believing. Keep on trusting me, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. May I remind us, in God's waiting room, God's doing a marvelous, miraculous thing in our lives. He's changing us. Changing us. Doing that work that will allow us to be molded and crafted into his image, carry out the task that he wants for us. Would you stand, please? Everyone standing everywhere. As we stand together, our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, as the music plays and as the Holy Spirit of God speaks. These moments of invitation, moments of decision. Perhaps you're here today and you say, "Preacher, I'm in God's waiting room."
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling.